Welcome to Learning English, a daily 30-minute program from the Voice of America. I'm Ashley Thompson.
And I'm Mario Ritter Jr. This program is designed for English learners, so we speak a little slower and we use words and phrases especially written for people learning English. This is what you will hear on today's program. Learn about Brazil's efforts to mine rare earth metals. Then, Ana Mateo and Andrew Smith tell us about ways to keep children at a healthy weight. Finally, we'll have the lesson of the day. Now, let's get started. Brazil aims to become a major producer of rare earth metals as Western countries push to gain supplies needed to manufacture high-technology devices. Rare earth metals are 17 elements that are important to electronic equipment and to batteries, electricity storage devices. South America's largest country could become a competitor to China, which currently produces much of the world's supply of the metals. Brazilian officials hope to move the country into the world's top five suppliers. Supporters of Brazil's push say low labor costs, existing rules, and being close to markets in Latin America are advantages. But currently, low prices for rare earth metals, technical difficulties, and concerns from possible lenders present problems. Brazil is believed to have the world's third largest supply, or reserves, of rare earth metals. Serra Verde is the country's first rare earth mine. The mine started operations this year. Experts, business leaders, and investors expect production to grow. Western governments are providing incentives. Daniel Morgan is with Barrenjoey, an investment bank in Sydney, Australia. Speaking about Brazil's possible rare earth supplies, Morgan said, "There have been some very meaningful discoveries made in the past couple of years." He added, "I do think outside of China, Brazil's projects are the most economic greenfield projects available." Greenfield normally means that the area involved is undeveloped or used only for agriculture. Currently, the United States and its allies depend almost completely on China for rare earth metals. However, the U.S. aims to develop its own supply chain for rare earths by 2027. The goal is to provide enough materials to meet the needs of the defense industry. China produced 240,000 metric tons of rare earth-related materials in 2023. That is 5 times more than the U.S., the next biggest producer. China processes about 90% of the world's supply to make permanent magnets, which are used in equipment such as wind turbines, electric vehicles, and missiles. Countries including Australia, Vietnam, and Brazil aim to increase production. But their efforts have been slow. In Brazil, Serra Verde has taken 15 years to develop. It is expected to produce 5,000 tons of rare earths once production starts. The company's chief, Tras Moraitis, says production could double by 2030. He said his company's mine and Brazil have competitive advantages that could aid development of the rare earths industry. These include geological qualities, electricity supplies, and a skilled workforce. But Moraitis said development will require continued support to establish itself in a highly competitive market. Key processing technologies are controlled by a small number of players. Reg Spencer, an expert with investment bank Canaccord, said the country could have two or three more mines by 2030. A barrier to getting big mining projects started has been a 70% drop in the price of many rare earth metals. That means banks will be less willing to lend money for rare earth projects. Nick Holthouse is chief of Australian developer Meteoric Resources. He said getting money at the moment is tough. The company is aiming to make an investment decision in late 2025 for its Caldeira project in Brazil's central state of Minas Gerais. It will produce both heavy and light rare earths. In March, the U.S. Export-Import Bank expressed interest in lending Meteoric Resources $250 million for the project. Brazilian rare earths is at an early point in developing resources in the country's northeast. The company's chief, Bernardo da Veiga, said it is much less costly to mine in Brazil compared to Australia. Although low labor costs help developers, most countries are behind China in processing and producing rare earths. To assist developers, Brazil's government has set aside $195 million to help finance important mineral projects, including mining rare earths. The Ministry of Mines and Energy said in a statement that it wants to build an industry for creating alloys and finished products like turbines, motors, and batteries. The ministry is also considering efforts to get rare earths from recycling old equipment and parts. Such an effort might save costs on developing separate technologies and establishing a new supply chain. I'm Mario Ritter Jr.
From VOA, Learning English, this is the Health and Lifestyle Report. For many parents in the United States, finding help for an overweight child is not easy. That is because the most widely suggested treatment is not widely available. Leading medical groups suggest intense behavioral counseling. These types of programs teach children and their families about easy ways to eat healthier and exercise more.
However, these programs have long waiting periods. They are often not covered by health insurance, and they require a lot of time. As a result, less than 1% of the nearly 15 million U.S. children who struggle with obesity get the recommended kind of care. That information comes from the U.S. Centers for Disease Control and Prevention, or CDC. Reporters with the Reuters news agency spoke with doctors, parents, and other experts about the difficulties of getting such treatment for obese children. The CDC and others have tried to expand insurance coverage for the behavioral counseling programs. But so far, that has not happened, doctors told Reuters. The coverage for these programs was never good, and we're not seeing any movement toward improvement, said Dr. Joseph Skelton. He is a professor of child medicine, or pediatrics. Skelton is also an obesity medicine specialist at Wake Forest University School of Medicine in North Carolina. Obesity among U.S. children has increased from 5% in 1980 to nearly 20% today, CDC experts say.
Novo Nordisk's weight loss drug Wegovy was approved for adults in 2021 and for adolescents in late 2022. The drug provides a highly effective way to lose weight. The drug maker still cannot meet demand for the drug among adults. Each week, there are at least 25,000 first-time users of the drug. A much smaller but growing number of families are seeking the drug for their adolescents, Reuters reported earlier this year. Many doctors and parents are unsure of using the medication. They do not know if Wegovy can affect a child's development or create other long-term risks. Ruth Medina of Holyoke, Massachusetts, was worried about her daughter, Jelani. At age 15, Jelani weighed over 90 kilograms. The family has a history of type 2 diabetes, a condition worsened by being overweight. Medina did not want that to happen. "That's when I got scared," Medina said. So she wanted to make healthy changes for her family and sought help. Jelani's doctor suggested the Healthy Weight Program at Holyoke Health Center. In this program, children and their parents meet with a food expert and a community health worker. Together, they set individual weight goals, cook healthy meals, learn how to read food labels, and talk about healthy lifestyle choices. Dr. Vinny Biggs runs the program. He said there is a 4-month wait to get into the program. Biggs said Medina and her daughter's treatment is partly covered by the state Medicaid health insurance. At the family's first meeting, Jelani prepared a rice and vegetable dish with her teachers. She and her mother both said they liked the healthy meal. Jelani has lost some weight. She started walking more, playing tennis, and eating more fruits and vegetables. However, her mother still worries about the appeal of the many fast food restaurants close to their home. For her daughter, they are tempting. "We walk by so many temptations," Medina said. "I want to do whatever I can to get her to a healthy weight."
Dr. Thomas Robinson is director of the Center for Healthy Weight at Stanford Medicine Children's Health in California. He said many of us believe it would make sense to offer behavioral counseling along with the drug. He added, these drugs are very effective at reducing weight and health risks, but you don't all of a sudden adopt a healthy diet or become more physically active, he said. With Stanford's lifestyle counseling program, instructors give parents and their children long-established lessons about eating wisely. They use the colors of a traffic light to teach these lessons. High-calorie foods, such as ice cream or even almonds, are red light foods. They should not be eaten often. Vegetables are green light foods. Kids can eat as many green light foods as they want. Most foods, Robinson explained, are yellow light and fall somewhere in between. Health insurance does not cover Stanford's program. So families pay out of pocket or receive financial help from the hospital, Robinson said. The full cost of the program is $3,500.
Since 2022, the CDC, American Academy of Pediatrics, and other experts have pushed for better insurance coverage of obesity counseling. In September, an American Medical Association, or AMA, group of experts rejected one of those efforts. The effort was a request for the creation of a medical code for the intensive program. This code would help providers bill insurance companies for their services. However, in a statement, the AMA told Reuters the application did not meet the group's standards. The AMA explained that a new code may not be approved by insurance providers if the programs include non-clinical services, such as cooking classes. Even if a new code is created, health insurers can still refuse to pay for medical services. In a statement to Reuters, the CDC said that guaranteeing fair access to both obesity medications and lifestyle treatment is critical. That would give families more choices when deciding how to best support their child's health. And that's the Health and Lifestyle Report. I'm Ana Mateo.
And I'm Andrew Smith.
And now we have Ana Mateo with us to explain more about the health report you just heard. Thanks for being with us, Ana.
Thanks for having me on your show.
This story was first published by Reuters. It talks about a struggle for many children, being overweight, or the issue of childhood obesity.
That's right. This story talks about a treatment for children who are struggling with weight gain. The treatment is not a drug, but rather intense behavioral counseling.
And what does this type of counseling involve?
These types of programs teach children and their families about easy ways to eat healthier and exercise more.
Well, thanks for taking some time to talk to us, Ana. We're looking forward to talking with you again.
Thanks for having me on your show.
Hello, my name is Ana Mateo.
My name is Andrew Smith.
And I'm Jill Robbins.
You're listening to The Lesson of the Day on the Learning English podcast. Welcome to the part of the show where we help you do more with our video series, Let's Learn English. This series shows Ana Mateo in her work and life in Washington, D.C.
Lesson 51 of the series is called A Good Habit. Today, we're going to talk about habits and about fitness.
A habit is something you do on a regular basis. On a regular basis means something that you do or that happens repeatedly and frequently.
For example, if you brush your teeth every day, you do that on a regular basis. So that means it is a habit.
And fitness is a noun. It means the state of having a strong and healthy body that can do a lot of exercise.
And the word fit is the adjective form of fitness. To be fit, you need to exercise on a regular basis.
And the expression to be in shape means the same thing as to be fit.
Over the last 50 years, running has become a popular way for people to stay fit or get in shape. And a big goal for many runners is to run a marathon. In Lesson 51, Ana thinks she can run a marathon too. Let's listen.
DC is a popular city for marathons. A marathon is a long race. Many marathons raise money for charities. You know, good works. A marathon is a good fitness goal, too. I want to challenge myself in a marathon and maybe win a medal. Hey, there's Ashley. Ashley, wait for me. It's Ana. Ashley. 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 Ashley.
Are you okay, Ana?
I just ran from over there. Woo! Running is really, really hard.
Do you want to sit down, Ana?
Yeah.
Do you want some water?
Woo!
No, thanks. You keep it.
Thanks. I didn't know you liked to run.
I love running. In fact, this weekend, I will run in my first marathon.
Me too!
Really? You are running in a marathon?
Yeah, in a couple of days. Why do you ask like that?
What do you know about running in a marathon?
I know that there's a lot of running. And sometimes you can win a medal.
And how long have you been training?
I started today. I've been training for an hour and 7 minutes.
Ana has only been training for about an hour. But to run a marathon, most people need to train for at least a few months.
Or a year. To train or to get in shape is an activity that takes place over a period of time. That's why Ashley and Ana used the present perfect continuous tense.
And how long have you been training?
I started today. I've been training for an hour.
Let's talk a bit more about marathons. The word marathon comes from a town in Greece named Marathon. According to tradition, a Greek runner named Pheidippides ran from Marathon to the city of Athens to deliver some important news.
The news was that the Greek military had defeated the powerful Persian military at the Battle of Marathon, and the distance from Marathon to Athens was about 40 kilometers. After the marathon was added to the modern Olympic sports competition, the official distance of the race became just over 42 kilometers.
And speaking of the modern event, in 2023, a 23-year-old man from Kenya named Kelvin Kiptum set a new world record for the fastest marathon ever run. he ran the Chicago Marathon in a time of 2 hours and 35 seconds.
Whoa. I read that the average time for most people is around 4.5 hours. So that means Kiptum was running more than twice as fast as the average runner. Many people wonder if anyone will ever be able to finish a marathon in under 2 hours.
Well, Kiptum is getting pretty close.
Now let's get back to Anna. She has made the mistake of underestimating how long it takes to train for a marathon.
To estimate is to make a guess about something. And to underestimate means to guess an amount that is too small.
And how long have you been training?
I started today. I've been training for an hour and 7 minutes.
Anna, training a little every day is a good habit to get into. Not all at once.
Her friend Ashley is right. To get fit, you need to get into the habit of exercising.
To get into the habit of doing something means to start doing something on a regular basis. And to develop a good habit, it sometimes helps to have a goal. Jill, do you have any fitness goals or things you want to get into the habit of doing?
I swim regularly. I try to swim at least 3 times a week. And every day I do yoga and walk about 3 miles with my dog. How about you, Andrew?
Right now, I think my problem is that I don't have a specific fitness goal. But I do exercise on a regular basis. But you know what? I have a friend who says I don't drink enough water. So maybe I can just get into the habit of drinking more water.
Well, anyway, I think drinking water should be an easy habit to get into. I've been reading a book lately about the habits of successful people. One of them is to start with the end in mind or have a goal, which is good for language learning too. For example, you could say, I want to get in the habit of listening to English at least 30 minutes a day with the Voice of America Learning English podcast. And Andrew, your goal is to get in the habit of drinking enough water. Listeners, did you notice that if we say the habit of, we use the ing form of the verb after it?
For example, we say the habit of drinking more water, the habit of exercising, the habit of reading, the habit of walking, and so on. After the preposition of, just remember to use the ing form.
Anna is not in the habit of running, so she is definitely not going to be able to finish a marathon. But luckily for her, the race she wants to run in is only for children.
I'm here to enter the race.
But ma'am, you can't enter the race.
What? How am I going to meet my goal?
Ma'am, this race is for children. You can't run with the children.
Children? Children? That's perfect. I just might win.
No, ma'am, you really can't run with the children.
I'm sorry, of course. I was only thinking of my goal.
Well, you could help us with our goal, which is to raise money for sick children. Would you like to help us?
Anna gets a new goal, to help the race raise money for sick children. At the end of the video, she helps the children and tells them they have done a good job.
I've just found my new goal, and I get to wear a medal. Good job!
Do you have any fitness goals or new habits you want to get into? Send us an email at learningenglish@voanews.com and let us know.
And remember, you can also find us on YouTube, Facebook, and Instagram. Thanks for listening. I'm Andrew Smith.
And I'm Dr. Jill.
And that's our program for today. Join us again tomorrow to keep learning English through stories from around the world. I'm Ashley Thompson.
And I'm Mario Ritter Jr.